So welcome to the first Punjabi Business Leaders Roundtable as part of the new Punjab, Pyara Punjab project. I am your host, Vipul Jani. Let me start with a brief introduction before we can open the roundtable. Impact Media and Events Corporation is a 20-year-old media and events company here in Canada. We publish Canada-India Insight, a free monthly e-paper dedicated exclusively to Canada-India relations. We organize an annual Celebrating Success Gala where we recognize prominent business leaders and community leaders from Canada, India, USA, and other countries, and raise funds for charity. We also organize an annual Canada-India Insight Conference, a Canada-India-USA trilateral conference, an annual IT conference, and many other initiatives. Canada-India-USA Development Forum, or CIUDF, is a Canadian not-for-profit organization that supports all these initiatives. It's a membership-based body with an advisory board made up of prominent business leaders from both countries, Canada and India. The forum is also launching a new health and wellness series, an education series, an immigration series, and several other state-to-state bilateral conferences in the coming weeks. The first state we have picked is Punjab, and today's business roundtable is part of the 18-month-long New Punjab, Pyara Punjab project. In the coming weeks and months, we will be hosting Punjab, Ontario, Punjab, BC, Punjab, Alberta virtual conferences, food festivals in Brampton and Vancouver, take a delegation to Punjab and Delhi, visit the Golden Temple, organize at least 20 such business and political roundtables. Today's roundtable will be followed by a Punjabi origin MP's roundtable on December 5. We'll be also launching a virtual coffee table book and several other projects to celebrate Punjab and the Punjabi community. We're also working on a couple of other states and provinces in both India and Canada, and we'll make formal announcements soon. So we request and invite the Punjabi business leaders, broader Indo-Canadian community, and friends of India to participate in and support these initiatives and projects so we can do more. A special thank you to our sponsors, Tangentia, Surti Sweetmart, ICICI Bank, and Seneca College for their continued support and participation, as well as the High Commissioner of India and Consul General of India to Toronto. So with that, let us begin. This is just a brief introduction of the project, you know, what we are doing. As part of this Punjab project, I was saying the webinars, the CEO roundtables, presentations on Punjab, the food fest, profiles of prominent Punjabi personalities. This is just to give you an idea of what the Punjab project is all about. And this roundtable is a part of it. So the Celebrating Success Gala will be done on the Punjab theme this time. We also want to do a Langar Seva as part of the project, political representatives event in Ottawa, and lots of virtual events. This is something that, you know, we'll be happy if we can get some support there in terms of sponsorships. Entirely optional, but your referrals, you know, will help. So with that, let us begin the roundtable, and we'll hear the format of this roundtable. We'll hear from all four panelists one by one for about 7 to 8 minutes each, followed by a panel discussion where they can discuss freely and ask other speakers about business, culture, philanthropy, anything else. You know, about Punjab and the Punjabi community. I will throw in one question myself also for the panel. So let me first invite our keynote speaker for today, the High Commissioner of India to Canada, His Excellency, Shri Ajay Visaria Ji, and let me read out his profile first. His Excellency Mr. Ajay Bisaria is the High Commissioner of India to Canada. He has a bachelor's degree in economics from Delhi University, a master's degree in business administration from Indian Institute of Management, Kolkata, and a master's degree in public policy from Princeton University, US. Prior to joining the diplomatic service, Mr. Bisaria worked briefly with American Express Bank and Bharat Heavy Electricals Limited, BHEL, in Delhi. After training at the Foreign Service Institute in New Delhi, Ajay Bisaria chose Russian as his language of specialization and was posted at the Indian Embassy in Moscow from 1988 to 1991, where he was attached to the economic and political wings of the embassy. He worked as a Soviet internal affairs specialist in the months leading up to the breakup of the USSR. He served as undersecretary in the Ministry of External Affairs on the East Europe desk 91-92, when India was engaged in building new relationships with the post-Soviet countries. He then moved to the Ministry of Commerce in the era of economic liberalization. He was posted as first secretary in the Indian Embassy in Berlin from 95 to 99, where he looked after commercial matters. Mr. Bisaria was appointed private secretary to the Prime Minister of India in 1999, where he looked after commercial matters. Ajay Bisaria was appointed private secretary to the Prime Minister of India in 1999 and served in this capacity till 2004. During most of this period, he was aide to the then Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee and contributed to various economic, defense, and foreign policy initiatives of the period. Mr. Bisaria was posted to the World Bank in Washington, D.C. as advisor to the Executive Director for South Asia. In 2009, he moved to Delhi to serve as Joint Secretary Eurasia in the Ministry of External Affairs. His assignment was to head the division coordinating overall policy and bilateral relations with the Eurasia region, including Russia, Ukraine, and Central Asia. He also worked on India's policy approach to multilateral entities like SCO and the Russia-India-China Trilateral Dialogue. He was India's ambassador to Poland, based in Warsaw, with concurrent accreditation to Lithuania from January 15 to November 17. From December 17 to February 2020, Ajay Bisaria served as the High Commissioner of India to Pakistan. He helped establish linkages for India to engage with a new Pakistan government led by Prime Minister Imran Khan. He was involved in furthering various initiatives, including the Kartarpur Corridor, and returned to India when Pakistan downgraded the diplomatic relationship in August 2019. He assumed office as High Commissioner of India to Canada on 1st March 2020. He holds the rank of Secretary to Government of India. Mr. Bisaria has published and lectured on issues of trade, finance, and diplomacy with a focus on South Asia, Eurasia, and Central Asia. He is fluent in Hindi, English, and Russian, and has working knowledge of German, Polish, and Urdu. Mr. Bisaria has a deep interest in yoga, plays golf, and enjoys reading. He is married to environmentalist and writer Bharti Chaturvedi, the founder of the NGO Chintan. So with that, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Vipulji. Thank you for that overly long and overly generous introduction of my.
Well, your accomplishments are so many. I mean, even if I try to cut down, it will still take me 2 pages.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That reminds me, I should have a 4-line introduction, which I can share with you, which can be used. But thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me, and greetings to all friends that I see on the screen in India and in Canada. Great to be here. And I again commend you for this Pyara Punjab initiative. It's, I think, a long overdue initiative. We've been doing it in bits and pieces, but it's great to have so much focus in such a strong, structured way in Punjab. You know, when before coming here in February, I visited Punjab. And the Chief Minister Amrinder Singh invited me for dinner. And I told the Honorable Chief Minister that I was posted in the old Punjab for a couple of years, and I used to go and catch crossover from the Wagah border when I went to Pakistan. Each time I'd take a flight to Amritsar, it was like a domestic flight and walk across. And now I've been posted to the newer Punjab, which means the Punjab where the strong connections between Canada and Punjab and the strong aspirations of Punjab folks to go towards Canada is something that is quite palpable and unique in Punjab. And in all my conversations in Punjab, there was a great deal of interest and particularly a great deal of knowledge of what was happening here. And this I see mirrored when I come here of the 1.6 million diaspora, this amazing diaspora in leadership positions in almost every sector, in politics, in business, in education and science. We see Punjab so well represented in this whole group that I think it's very important to look at it in a very focused way. You know, when I had these conversations in Punjab with in West India with the Punjab leadership, I see a great deal of appetite to formally now and create bridges with Canada, and not just the bridge between with diaspora, but between Punjab as a state and at the same time trying to leverage the great deal of goodwill and the great deal of emotional connections that exists. So what I did before, I thought to kick off the conversation, I asked Invest Punjab, what they plan to do with Punjab, because this is a new and dynamic organization I met when I had gone there, and they are conceptualizing how they would like to engage with Canada and particularly with the diaspora in Canada. So what they tell me is that in Punjab, they have tried to create a cluster method of industrial development, focusing on developing several new parks to attract investments. And what they have is upcoming state-of-the-art mega parks. So they are inviting investment now to mega parks, which is a 1,000-acre modern industrial park in Ludhiana, one a manufacturing cluster in Patiala, bulk drug park in Bhatinda, each over 1,000 acres. And then there is a pharma park in Sri Fatehgarh Sahib and an upcoming biotech park and ESDM park. So I think there is a great deal of interest in Punjab to make this all very real rather than just talking points in the overall context of an India which is becoming much more investor friendly. And with Canada, we have seen Canada voting with its feet, because if there's one takeaway I have of my 8 months here in Canada and the multiple conversations with economic actors, it's a strong faith in India's long-term story. So the investment firms, the pension funds, they have gone up from 2014 of an investment of $5 billion to $60 billion. Today, the biggest investor in India is not no longer BlackRock of the US, but it is Brookfield of Canada with $19 billion odd. We have Fairfax from Toronto, which has dramatically increased its investments. So there's a great deal of faith in India's long-term story. And the question I had asked Punjab was, why doesn't Punjab tap into these investments? So what we were trying to do, for instance, is organize a roundtable of major investment firms in Punjab and for them to be invited to Chandigarh and have this conversation. So this is also something that is in the works. In terms of business opportunities sectorally, we have certainly agriculture and food processing as the number one opportunity. We had food processing technologies is what Punjab needs, and Canada has them in abundance. We have had multiple conversations on this. The former food processing minister, Badalji, Simrat Kaur Badalji, was someone who was engaging on this, and I'm sure her successors are too. But this is something of great interest. There is iron and steel, particularly given the dominant position in light engineering and the secondary steel sector. But the new interest is in education. And this is something where Punjab has created the infrastructure in Mohali to have educational institutions which can come to India from Canada. And this is an offer we are discussing with multiple universities in Canada, the top universities, whether they can consider opening a campus, given all these incentives in Punjab. And we have a situation, of course, of 230,000 Indian students coming every year, many of them from Punjab to Canada, and this number is growing. So the idea was to also create some downstream engagement and have campuses available in India. And the other area of interest is, I believe, media and entertainment, which is something where there are huge opportunities, and Vipul would know well the kind of conversations going on in the entertainment space, not just of creating joint content, but creating larger structures like a project for a film city and so on. So I think I'll stop right here. The whole idea was to just give you a quick overview of the availability of options, the huge interest within Punjab on doing business with Canada, much of which I'm seeing mirrored on the Canadian side. Thank you.
Nice. That was fantastic, sir. Thank you so much for giving us your time again today and sharing your views with us. Let me now invite our first panelist for today, Mr. Pavi Binning. Pavi Binning is the president and a director of Whittington Investments Limited. He's also a director on the board of George Weston Limited and Loblaw Companies Limited. Whittington Investments is the private holding company owned by the Weston family, which controls the Weston group of companies, including George Weston Limited, Loblaw Companies Limited, Shoppers Drug Mart, Choice Properties REIT, Weston Foods, and the Selfridges Group. Mr. Binning was previously the president and CEO of George Weston Limited, one of Canada's largest public companies, having joined the group in 2010. Mr. Binning has an extensive range of public company experience from industries including food, alcoholic beverages, telecommunications, retail, and building materials. Prior to joining Weston, Mr. Binning was at Nortel Networks, where he initially held the role of Chief Financial Officer and subsequently Chief Restructuring Officer. In this role, Mr. Binning led the company, including all of Nortel's operating businesses and corporate functions, through its restructuring. Prior to coming to Canada, Mr. Binning was a board member and the Chief Financial Officer of Hansen PLC and Marconi Corporation PLC, both major international companies headquartered in the UK. He held these roles after spending 17 years at Diageo PLC, one of the world's leading consumer goods companies. So in a number of corporate and operational roles. Over to you, Paviji.
Great, Vipul, thank you very much. And I echo what the High Commissioner said. Thank you for inviting me, you know, to join you this morning. And I think the initiative that you've launched is great and very, very welcome. And, you know, I know there's lots of aspects to that, and I'm sure it will be, you know, very, very helpful, not only for the Punjabi community, but, you know, even the wider community as we sort of move forward, as they learn about Punjab as we move forward. I think you've done a sort of a great job in terms of giving a little bit of background, you know, to me, but some sort of interesting things. I was born in Punjab. I was, you know, 6 months old when my parents moved to the UK. You can probably tell from the accent that I haven't got a Canadian accent, I've got a UK accent. And they moved, really to sort of try and have a better life for their children at that point in time, because we didn't have much when we were sort of in India. And I grew up as part of a first generation family, went to school at five, not knowing a word of English, because at home we spoke Punjabi. And then really, you know, it was a difficult time in the UK for immigrants back in the 1960s. There was a lot of tension, you know, from a racial perspective, as the country was bringing in people from either Asia or the Caribbean, etc., etc. But I grew up in the UK, and you know, was educated there. An interesting fact: I had applied for universities, had been accepted by universities, but never actually went to university because my parents couldn't afford to send me to university. And so I was fortunate that a firm sponsored me to do my CA qualification, and then worked for that firm for a while and grew my career. And very fortunately, I joined a company called Diageo, which was a global consumer goods company, as you sort of said earlier. And this company really didn't care where I came from or who I was. They were very focused on performance, and I grew up in that company from junior positions to be the deputy CFO of the group for the last 5 years. At that time, I actually did a lot of work with them in India. India was one of the markets that we went into and started to sort of build a business, as we did with many emerging markets around the world. From there, I went into one of the major turnarounds in the UK called Marconi, which was the bellwether of the UK that had fallen on hard times. We turned around the company, joined Hansen, and again, made a series of strategic moves and ended up actually selling the company. And then came to Canada in 2007 to Nortel, which was, again, a major turnaround, global company, major turnaround in Canada. And then in the Great Recession, the company went into, CCAA. And the board asked me to take over the running of the company. I told them that I didn't want to be called the chief executive because there was a history as to what happened with chief executives at Nortel. But I led the company and restructured and then sold off all the different pieces of a global entity. I joined the Western family then in 2010, as you said, and have been with them ever since. I now am president and CEO of the holding company. And we have five major businesses in our group. We are the biggest grocer in Canada. We are the biggest pharmacy operator in Canada and have thousands of stores across the country. We're the biggest real estate company in Canada. We have a foods operation that encompasses North America with 50 major facilities across North America. And we are a major player in the luxury retail industry, with primarily in Europe, with the Selfridges Group. Our revenue is about $60 billion, and we have 250,000 people in the company. But right the way through my career, and we'll talk about this, I'm sure, later, the roots that I came from and the background that I came from has been very, very important to me. I always sort of have said to myself that, the values with which I grew up, and these values, many of you will know are Punjabi values, was the basis on which I would develop my career. I haven't modeled myself, on anyone in this other, the Western world. And there are cultural issues when you're trying to develop a career. When you come from an Asian background, behaviors and culture is different to what you would experience in the Western world, which is where I've built my career. But I've been true to those, values and roots. And I think it's, certainly served me well as I built my career in the West. So, Vipul, I think with that, I think it's best to sort of stop. And I'm sure that, we'll have lots of discussion as we do the, the panel session.
Absolutely. That is such an impressive life story, Paviji. Very inspiring, I am sure, for people that are listening or watching, or we'll be reading, in the paper soon. So thank you once again for all that you have done, all you have achieved. and for being a role model for so many. So now let me invite the second panelist for today, Supreet Varna. Supreet Varna is the Chief Operating Officer for Wealth and Personal Banking, HSBC Bank Canada. As a senior executive leader, Supreet oversees many diverse teams that support the retail and wealth business. Her mandate includes channel optimization, transformation, controls, fraud, AML and risk, analytics and data governance, credit services and collections, business management and sales effectiveness, employee engagement, operational effectiveness, and cost oversight. Supreet has over 20 years of experience in channel and distribution strategy and operational transformation with a special focus on retail and business banking. 12 of those years were with one of the big five Canadian financial institutions. In that time, she had the opportunity to transform the branch banking experience, transform the role of contact center, and build remote distribution channels to better meet customer needs. Through her experiences, Supreet has developed a deep understanding of the unique challenge of operating a retail banking business in an evolving customer landscape while meeting regulatory and risk demands. In addition to her role as Chief Operating Officer, Supreet serves as a director for four subsidiary boards for HSBC Bank Canada and for the Ficanex group of companies. Supreet is passionate about diversity and inclusion and has held leadership positions in many diversity affiliation groups. Supreet is a proud mother of two wonderful children and enjoys learning Indian classical music and taking Bollywood dance classes in her spare time. Over to you, Supreet.
Thank you for that, Vipul. So nice to see everyone on the panel and be with such an esteemed group of panelists this morning. And congratulations again on this initiative. I do think it's a wonderful initiative. I know when we spoke, you wanted me to speak a little bit about my Punjabi roots and what that meant to me. And I was thinking about what I would say because I think I am, personification of, you know, the future of so many Punjabis who've come to Canada and are hoping to see what the next generation, what their kids look like in Canada as they grow up in this Canadian landscape. We came to this country when I was 3 years old. My father, proud Punjabi, proud Sardar, wanted to make a better life for his children. And, so growing up primarily in Canada, I knew that I was Punjabi always. Knew that I was a proud Sikh girl from a proud Sikh family always. But I don't know that I actually knew what being Punjabi really meant, other than Punjabi classes at the local Gurdwara to learn to read and write. Until I went back to India, I think I was probably around 15 at that time. And my father took us to the village where he grew up. And it's a small village, Singhpura near Gurdaspur in Punjab. And he showed us his roots, where he, and his parents first established and grew their family. And I remember entering that village, very small village, and seeing, you know, the entire community of the village come out to greet us. And everybody knowing who we were, and I didn't know who they were. And then going and being introduced to the Gurdwara, the temple that my father had actually and his family had built in the village for the community there. And I didn't know that my father had actually done that. So this was a real awakening for myself and my two brothers going to Punjab and seeing this. And then seeing the courtyard where my father first had his schooling under a tree with a chalkboard, and seeing children being educated for the first years of schooling in exactly the same way, under the same tree. There was a group of young children with a teacher and a chalkboard. And my father, who's now a marine engineer, never spoke about that being his first experience with schooling outside under a tree. And I think what became very meaningful to me through that experience. And seeing my father interact with his village, with the community in his village, was, despite coming to Canada, leaving India, achieving all that he had achieved in his life as a marine engineer, and establishing his family for you know, what he believed would be a better future, he never forgot his village. He never forgot his roots. He never forgot to give back. And through that experience, instilled a sense of responsibility in us as children to remember that very same foundation, to remember that we are part of a community, that we are part of a community that supports each other. You know, I saw every one of those families in the village. I think might have been the happiest community to see my father's success, because for them, he was their family. And, you know, they were seeing him, they were seeing us as children, you know, outside and taking on additional opportunities. Until this day, I receive, you know, messages from people that I met on that trip, you know, who are following my career, who are following my accomplishments, my brothers in the same way. And so initiatives like this, I think for certainly first generation Punjabis, but almost second generation. I know, you know, technically I'm first because I came here when I was 3 and was born in India, but in many ways, almost like a second generation Punjabi. They remind us that we are part of a community, that we have these roots that bind us. And, you know, there's so much opportunity for us, whether it's through, you know, the bank that I work for and supporting the Punjabi community when they send their children here as students to, you know, to study and make a life for themselves, whether it's through our community and giving back and paying it forward in initiatives. And I saw, Vipulji, you were, you know, talking about some of the initiatives that you want to support in the future. Langar Seva came up. What a wonderful initiative for the community, really. I've actually gone and made rotis at the Gurdwara with that group and been part of those you know, part of those activities. And there's nothing more rewarding than giving back to your community in this way. So really, really proud in so many ways of my Punjabi roots, my Punjabi heritage, but really very grateful to you for really bringing us together and being able to share, hopefully with the community at large, and finding ways to be able to promote, to give back, and to highlight the accomplishments and the opportunities with both Punjab as a state and with our community here.
Thank you very much, Supreet. Again, we are so happy to have you amongst us. And I am so happy, so proud to have so many role models today, you know, as part of the same roundtable. So thank you again for all you are doing and for being an inspiration to many. So as just to remind once again, as Supreet rightly said, the theme for today is proud to be a Punjabi, and how it has, how my roots have shaped my life and my work. So this brings us to the third speaker from India. I mean, the first, they are only one from India, the third panelist of today, Vaibhav Vora. He has been listening quietly. So Vaibhav Vora is the managing director of Global Supply Chain Management Provider Continental Group, headquartered in New Delhi, but he is now based in Mumbai, right? As you said?
Yes.
He is an international business leader with close to 2 decades of strong experience in partnering with global CEOs and CXOs of Fortune 500 organizations in driving growth through supply chain efficiencies. Armed with a degree in entrepreneurship and finance from Boston, USA, Vaibhav took the leap into aerospace and sensitive goods supply chain management in 2009. Today, Continental Group is a global leader in aviation supply chain management and is also a founder member of the Royal Aeronautical Society in India. Under his leadership, the group further diversified into logistics infrastructure by launching India's first greenfield air freight station in New Delhi. Very recently, He has led the group's foray into hospitality, media, and production. The group also has vast interest in real estate development, agribusiness, and air travel agency. Vaibhav currently serves as the chairman for the Logistics and Maritime Committee at the Indo-French Chamber of Commerce and also the Regional Director South Asia for Aviation Logistics Network. Vaibhav also has a pretty long and impressive profile. Unfortunately, I had to cut it down to one page here, you know, but I'm sure we'll be able to tell people more about you. And although he is a very successful businessman in his own right, he also has very famous in-laws, if I can say. I hope, Vaibhav, you don't mind if I tell people.
Go ahead. I think that connects me more to Punjab with my father-in-law. So.
Absolutely. So Vaibhav is the son-in-law of the, dare I say, first family of Punjab, Dharmendra and Hema Malini.
Well, that's another parallel introduction that I get to carry now. So thank you, Vipulji, for the grand introduction. But it's nothing compared to, I guess, the rest of the people on the panel that are here today. So really very fortunate to be here amongst everyone. And, as I can say that in my understanding, in my connection to Punjab, I can first start off with my professional experience, which is slightly lesser in terms of the years of experience compared to the rest of the people in the panel, but I believe has a lot of relevance and there's a lot to do with the roots that I hold. So again, I'm managing director of Continental Carriers, which is a large supply chain and logistics organization with its roots firmly planted in India over the last 63 years. This whole journey started back in 1947 when my grandfather actually moved from Gujranwala town in Punjab in Pakistan over to India. And, from Gujranwala came to Delhi. So that's where all the journey started. In fact, sir, Your Excellency, when you mentioned American Express, that was exactly the first place where he started his first job. I remember very clearly all growing up, these were the sort of stories that we were made to hear and sort of become role models for us to, learn from and take forward from. So his experience traveling with a family, five sisters and setting himself up from a completely established business in Pakistan and, erstwhile Punjab and coming into Delhi, setting everything from scratch, starting a very, good job or opportunity with American Express, having an opportunity to go again for better prospects to the US when an opportunity was given, but chose to stay in India as he believed that this was where he could do better for his family and decided to settle down and start the organization in 1957. From him is, where you hear about stories and it's always growing up, Punjabis, as they say, again, they've always compared Punjabis to be more risk takers or courageous or fun loving, strong. I don't know if they also consider us to be fools rushing in, but that's exactly where it makes you wonder where you get your roots and these kind of DNA from. So when I look back at his story and the story of countless other people that have come in from Punjab and have traveled all over the world, have dealt with all sorts of challenges, it just teaches you that, okay, this is people have done this and they've survived. And they've done so much better for themselves that it gives you a lot of courage to take that risk that is necessary. And that's why I believe we could be that generation of risk takers as well as Punjabis per se. So that's, with me, I have still been blessed with quite a lot. I can say, born with a silver spoon, but kept to ground with the Punjabi value system. I think, the Punjabi love is such that it comes in abundance and the Punjabi pyar and daant comes with as much as you can say the strictness as well comes with the approach. So that was what was bestowed on me. I think I was thrown into the deep end of the business at about 14 when we had an onboard courier business at that time. So I was flying as an onboard courier in my free time, learning the trade, learning the business, because there was no such thing as learning business from outside. You had to get in there and get your hands dirty to understand how things were done. And at that time, there was a law that required you to travel. So I did that. And it was one day trips across to London or the US even and turn around and come back. And I did this from the age of 13 or 14 in my free time. I was in with my grandfather learning on the documentation, how things work. And again, there was never a sense of being too comfortable. So that love came with its own sense of experience and I really cherish it till this day. You again move forward, and you see that again, this is how early when you're thrown into the deep end, you learn how to swim and you learn how to learn how things are done. More of the risk-taking is connected now with the comfort that is available with the Punjabi community worldwide. When you travel, being in a global business, that's a very essential thing, being able to travel and connect to everyone, especially your community around, source new opportunities, bring them back into India, and vice versa. So I guess that's been sort of the advantage I've been able to take leverage of being part of the Punjabi diaspora or Punjabi community here. So while I'm not born in Punjab, I'm born in Delhi, but now living in Mumbai, I can say I'm still very connected to Punjab as I can be, staying right here in India. So I think that's from my side, Vipulji.
Thank you, Vaibhav. So good to be able to connect to you. And I must say at a relatively short notice as well. We had less than 2 weeks since we reached out to you. But thank you once again for giving us the time at such a short notice. And as I said, we will continue to reach out to you and to many other people for your help, support, and guidance and referrals to carry out this project over the next year and a half, 18 months. Right. So now that brings us to the final panelist for today before we move on to the panel discussion. Surjit Babra is the chairman and CEO of Skylink Capital Corporation. He's a serial entrepreneur. He's also the vice chairman and partner of Highbury Canco Corporation, a food processing company with a 2 million square feet plant and 650 employees in Leamington, Ontario. Surjit is the CEO for Global Travel Software, chairman and shareholder for Fairlink.com, a wholesale travel company, and he runs Skylink Children's Charity, Babra Family Foundation. Previously, he was the chairman of Skylink Aviation, International Air Charter and Leasing Service, and chairman for Skylink Express, a domestic aviation company. Surjit was also chairman, master franchisee Canada for Dollar Rent a Car. A recipient of several high-profile awards, Surjit Babra's Skylink Children's Charity has contributed to Haiti, Sick Kids Hospital, and many other children causes, including the Canadian Soldiers Benevolent Fund. His new venture, Langar for the Mind, a non-profit organization, conducts free motivation and self-improvement seminars. Surjit enjoys spending his free time traveling, investing in self-improvement, gardening, golfing, and mentoring. The last part, mentoring, I can vouch for it because I have run through all my, you know, ideas, some of them not so smart, maybe some of them practical, but I brainstorm with him and he always tells me as it is, you know, if it's good, bad, stupid, do it, don't do it. So thank you for all of that. And his profile actually runs into 5 pages, which I had to cut down to 3 paragraphs. So I feel so sorry, you know, so everybody's profile was so impressive, but I only had 1 page in which to fit it in. So anyway, over to you, Surjit Bhai.
Hey, thank you. Wow, to follow up all this esteemed panelists, it's going to be a challenge. So anyway, I'm Punjabi. What they say in Punjabi, chakde fate, no problem. So the subject you had said was proud to be Punjabi and how my roots have saved my life. First of all, proud to be Punjabi. Punjabis, according to me, are really hardworking, extrovert people. Yeah, they are outgoing people. It's just by nature. And we can go back to the history why they are like that. They are open and embracing, more open and embracing community than number of other communities. All communities are embracing, but they can embrace Chinese, they can embrace I have gone to South America and they are there, you know, embracing everything. So they are they have this ability to risk take and navigate through that. That is a great and again it comes right from the centuries of culture of Punjab. I also think the ability, everybody knows, oops, I lost somebody. Okay.
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, I seem to have lost the video. Okay, no problem. I'll just carry on with that.
Yeah, we can see you. We can hear you.
Okay. So everybody knows the aspects of Bhangra and culture. I think because the Punjabis are a joyous culture, kind of Bhangra dances, temple visits, and gatherings, we are a bit better at handling stressful situations because we balance them out with all the festivals and activities we have and the bondings we have within the community. I also think, Punjabi culture values relationships and bonding and loyalty. But the other great thing about Punjabis is they have a higher level of empathy. By the way, these are my views only about Punjabi culture. They also belong to other cultures. But empathy is a great feature of Punjabis. Now, you had a second part, which basically states how my roots have shaped my life and work. I am fortunate to have been born in a great family. My parents were reasonably educated and showed me the path and taught us how to lead life. My immediate family and my extended family and the community is also strong and are a support system to hold you up. I also think I'm blessed and I am a very self-motivated person because I guess I've come to the University of Hard Knocks, unlike others, and I have the ability to seek help and attract good teachers that guide me through life. In coming back to the roots, I think religion has played an important and integral part of me. Through the connections of religion, I not only enjoy the festivals, I also lean on religion when times and things are bad. So it is my insurance policy, you could say, and that has helped me to stand and overcome any obstacle in life. Also, I would say the fundamental principles that have been taught to us have been playing a great role in my life, and that is the six fundamentals, basically. Naam, Japna, Kirt, Kamai, and Manchakra basically means to remember God and be thankful for what you have got in life, and to work an honest living, which is easier said than done. But if you stick to the principles, you will come out as a winner. Also, in the Kirt, Kamai, it's linked to remembering God. Basically, if you are a strong believer, then greed is contained then, and happiness has a room in your head. One Shakna is another very important part, which comes from the Punjabi culture, where I come from, and that is to share your earnings with the less fortunate. I could go on and on, other principles of my life that governed me, or, to avoid kaam, krodh, lobh, moh, ahankar, which is basically taught by our gurus. This is to avoid lust, anger, greed, emotional attachments, and ego. One thing I would also say that, I hang my coat also on the karma. If I get something or I don't get something in life, I put it to karma and move on. I don't hang around a subject or issue too long. And that has been very helpful in my life to succeed. Everybody can see me, recognize me from the turban. That is the Punjabi, turban. And I think, we forget that, but turban is a uniform that reminds me daily of the discipline in my life I have to have. And I will finish off with a very small sentence. The greatest thing I've had from Punjabi culture is Chardi Kalam, the most precious gift in my life from my religion is to always remain in a positive state of mind. Vipul, you are probably my witness. I have never been in a negative state of mind, and I don't even hang around negative people. So to have these points from my culture and my family have been who I am. And I could talk long on this, but this is what I get. Frankly, Chardi Kala is also, as a CEO, the position, you know, when you sit on a CEO position and top position, the issue is it's a very lonely position. Most people don't realize that. And Chardi Kala, or having a positive state of mind, is very important. And by this, I hand it back to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Surjit Bhai. You know, being positive, I can certainly vouch for it. I know him for many years now, I would say 4 or 5 years at least. We keep in regular touch, phone, emails, personal meetings. I have never ever heard a single negative line coming out of his mouth. Last week, I would say, if I can share, Surjit Bhai, he fell down and hurt his knees. So when I was asking him, you know, how did all that happen and how does he feel? Believe it or not, he told me that I'm lucky that I don't have my eyes in my knees. Otherwise, I would have gone blind. So, I mean, you know, he was not really upset or negative that he hurt his knees. He was saying that, oh, I'm lucky I don't have my vision or my eyes, you know, in that area. So that's one way, positive way of looking at it. So thank you for all that. And it certainly helps, you know, me and I'm sure a lot of other people who are facing challenges, but they learn how to still stay focused and positive and keep doing your efforts. And one day it may all pay off. So thank you for all the individual remarks, fantastic remarks. And so now we will move to the second segment, which is a panel discussion. So although, I mean, in this panel, it's an open panel, meaning that any of the panelists can ask a question to any of the other speakers. I would just like to, as an opening question, I would like to throw in one question myself, which all of you can answer. And then, as I mentioned, feel free to ask anybody anything you like. So the Sikh population, that's what I've always wondered. The Sikh population in India is roughly about 21 million, less than 2% of India's total population. But they are a major force to reckon with in agriculture, politics, business, army, entertainment, music, several other sectors. Why is it so? Why are you guys so special?
Who do you want to start? Okay, I'll start. You have to follow where the Sikh population comes from, Punjab. That's basically at the border of India. We've had many invasions, so continuous invasions in India, and that's where the first ones getting the brunt of this thing has been that community, which is now the Punjabi community. So they have become fighters. They had to defend their family, so the bonding has created. So it has, the over the call it centuries, it has developed into that phase. Mind you, farmers are also another thing is they farmed the lands that were not they were between the rivers, so they were good fertile land. But farming is not an easy job to do. You have to grow and take the risk. So you grow seeds today, just like in your career, you grow seeds today. You don't know what the outcome is tomorrow. So they are very risk-oriented people because farming itself is a risk organ. You grow, you don't know what will happen. Snow would come or the locust would eat you. So over the centuries, we have grown to risk-prone. We have grown to fighting and defending. And that basically means when there are few people left in the family, you bond together a lot. And sometimes you have to go, your lands are occupied, and just like 47, you have to go to new land, start life again. And over these many years, this has happened. It is not that we are sitting on a seaside and take, you know, get fish and eat. And it's been a hard life. So now that's they take that same ability, then go around, and now you see them. The end of Chile, you know, you see a Sikh family farming. What are you doing in Chile? I'm farming here. They don't even speak Spanish. So I think it's culturally the portion of India we've been there, and everything that has mattered to us depend, you know, besides the religion, but just the way we have been located in life, it has helped us to be, has trained us. Or let's talk, let's say we've been through the University of Hard Knocks in right in that region. Yes, Maya.
Can I just build on Vipul, the comments that you know, Bhajisajith has made? I think it has a lot to do with history and background. And I think you know, I mean, we just heard about the sort of the history of the people of Punjab. And I think that was reinforced undoubtedly by our the religion, you know, in Punjab as well, in terms of, you know, the very, you know, values that the gurus, you know, put forward as to how we ought to live our lives, in terms of that you do look after yourself, your land, your family, etc. But what you do is, you know, honesty and integrity in the way that you do, you know, your work and go about your, you know, sort of life absolutely does matter. And we've been taught, as many of you will know, that the person that you are really matters. And so therefore, what you don't do is you don't cheat people, you don't do, you know, things in a particular way, but what you do is you work hard, you show commitment, you know, dedicate yourselves to things. And, you know, we see that in Punjab. And when people come from overseas to the Western world, and I saw it with, you know, my own father, you know, who came with absolutely nothing. And many of the Punjabi community, as they came to places like England, to Canada, to America, you know, came with virtually, you know, nothing in their pockets. But that commitment and determination in terms of the background made them successful, you know, wherever they went in the world. And, you know, you will not find many, you know, Punjabi families, even in the West, you know, that haven't actually built a good life for themselves, you know, in these, you know, sort of generations that have come over. And it doesn't matter which part of the world, they are focused on building their own lives. And you see Gurdwaras everywhere in the world, wherever you go, where I've traveled all over the world in my career, and virtually in every city that I've gone to, which shows the sort of power and the success of the community to collaborate and come together. But I think that it has a great, great deal, you know, to do with that sort of background and history, you know, that was mentioned by Padi Sajid, because I think that's the foundation of who we are as a people.
I think those are great comments, Babaji and Sujitji. I absolutely agree with you in your comments as well. I think the only thing I would add, Vipulji, I mean, certainly from a personal perspective, faith is very, very important to me. The things that Sujitji spoke of, Naam Japna, Kirtkana, Ivan Chakna, and staying in Chardikala, I think is the foundation of many, almost every Sikh that I know, you know, very, very important and close to us as fundamentals of how we live our lives. There's also a factor of identifiable, or just our you know, our identity. The fact that we see each other, we're identifiable in the community through our physical appearance. And so I think that it does play a part, you know, certainly growing up from a traditional Sikh family, having my hair, wearing a gura every day. My parents always taught me that when you walk down the street, people know who you are. You are a Sikh in your identity. You are a Sikh in how you appear to the outside world. And so your actions, how you carry yourself, what you achieve is not only for you, but it's a representation for the community. And I think when you have that physical identifiability as a community, it does place also a sense of purpose to each of us to represent that community well. And I've always felt that. I know many of my friends, family seats, I see that thread throughout in many seat individuals who are successful. So I just wanted to raise that point as well, because I think it does actually play a factor.
No, I think I just agree. In the, you know, it's in fact, just to echo what everybody said, it's a lot to do with the history. You know, if you just go way back and look into Punjab, you know, from the 16th century onwards, you've just seen some of the other major event always bypassing there at some point, you know, and whether it was, you know, with the Mughal Empire, or was it with, you know, the British in the late 1800s, you saw always a lot of uncertainty that was there and a lot of moving around. You saw the Punjab roots, people were always moving around. There's a lot of uncertainty, but you have to live with that uncertainty. Something what, you know, Sujitji mentioned as well, is that somehow I think the community also has a fun-loving aspect attached to it that keeps the stress at balance, because, you know, it was very stressful. It kept everybody on their toes, and everybody had to realize, you know what, you don't know how tomorrow's going to turn out. And that was what you can see at every corner, you know, and you kept close to family, and you sort of carried those traditions forward. Mm-hmm. Same in 47, when, you know, the state was split right in the center, and people came over. People didn't know how families are going to live and how they're going to survive. And you saw that, you know, they did take defeat as an option. You know, it was something that you had to do. You had to wake up every morning, and then you had to go out and experience the struggle and come back, because that is just a large part of the DNA of the Punjabi, you know, community, and sort of that is what has left as, you know, the moral code that the future generations have picked up and aspire to take from. You know, those are the values that remain there, and no matter where you are in the world after that, that's the only way of life that you are used to and know of, you know.
Sir, Ajayji. Your microphone is on mute.
Yes, I've been listening with great interest. I think these are great comments and a great assessment in terms of your question of what drives this community, certainly history, certainly the religion, certainly the culture. And I would add that, you know, what is remarkable is that despite not being a coastal community, because through history you've seen coastal communities which tend to migrate using sea routes, but this was a spirit that came from other directions, not just the fact that you happened to be near a coast and it was easy to get into a ship and travel the world. So I think these are all good answers in terms of the drivers we've seen historically. But on a slightly larger point, I think hearing the four speakers today, we have a very good kind of fix of what values mean, what Punjabi values are, which is what you set out to discuss this morning. And I think I would summarize them as, from what our speakers said, certainly hard work, the risk-taking abilities and the appetite for adventure that came out of immigration, the hard work and the risk-taking, converting these into success stories. And this followed by the feeling of seva, that you needed to give back. And having achieved this success, you wanted to share it with the larger community locally, even back home, and giving back to the roots, to continue to be committed to the roots where you came from. I think that is a very strong feeling that comes out of all these four conversations. And, you know, we see the evidence of it, because even in pandemic times, we are doing 8 flights a week from Canada to India. There are people traveling back and forth. These routes, these connections stay very strong. When I went to Punjab and traveled around and talked to a lot of people, I saw that as well. The connection with the roots, the desire to give back is strong. And I think now the point which we've been making is that Punjab itself wants to connect very strongly with its diaspora and see what we can do together. So we can get into those details as we take this conversation forward.
Absolutely. So, I mean, as we have heard and as I firmly believe, it's a remarkable community. I mean, just the facts, you know, speak for themselves. Punjabis are the people that defend us at the border. They are the community that feed us with food, you know, through hard work in their farms. Punjabis are the community that entertain us through their music, you know, art, Bhangra, movies. They are also the leaders who lead us in governance. So, I mean, it's an unparalleled community. I mean, very, very hard to match in terms of achievements. So, wonderful to hear all these remarks. And so now I'll give a few minutes if anyone wants to ask a question to any other speaker or panelist. And just like, sorry, one more thing. Just as we did in our Canada-India Insight Conference on September 30th, we had a fantastic presentation from Invest India. So now as part of this project, as the High Commissioner has mentioned a couple of times, we would love to reach out and promote Invest Punjab, you know, and to connect them to Ontario, Alberta, BC, and overall business community here in Canada, where both can, you know, benefit mutually. So looking forward to that in the days to come. So now, again, as I said, open panel, anyone feel free to ask any other panelist, anything you want to ask.
Could I ask the High Commissioner a question? It's Pabi, High Commissioner. And you talked a little bit about, you know, sort of something that I think is on, you know, the minds of many Punjabis, which is the development of Punjab as we sort of, you know, move forward, because there are obviously parts of India that have been very successful in, you know, garnering investment, the communities that, you know, maybe overseas. You know, in terms of your, you know, discussions, how, you know, do you see that developing? What are the sort of, if you like, the priorities in terms of, you know, Punjab, and how can the diaspora, as you sort of look forward, really make a difference to the development of Punjab as we move forward?
Absolutely. I think great question. This is exactly what we have been having conversations on. If you look at the big picture, this is an India that is changing fairly dramatically. You know, it's moving from rhetoric to action on the ground. And even during pandemic times, we've seen a range of reforms. It was the idea was not to waste a good crisis. And so we saw a series of reforms in land, labor, capital laws, in agriculture, in education, in health. And the other phenomenon that is accompanying it is a strong sort of competition almost between the states of India. And many of these next gen reforms really have to move to the states. So you are going to invest in the state which will give you the best land deal and tell you that you won't have labor issues. So what UP does is it scraps some labor laws and it creates land banks to offer investors this. Now, speaking from Punjab's point of view, I was very impressed by what I saw and also the appetite to listen to what the investors are saying in Punjab. So I've been in conversation with Invest Punjab, which is incidentally a newer body, as professionally organized as any sort of corporate institution. I have a call with them next week and I'm going to give them some of this feedback. But the point is that this is now a Punjab and an India willing to listen to partners and wanting that feedback and wanting to know how to do better and wanting to do better than the next state. You know, they want to do better than Gujarat or Telangana or and be in the top states. From specifically from Punjab's point of view, there is this emotional connect and this already existing diaspora, you know, of the 4%, perhaps 2%, half of the 1.6 million in Canada are of Punjabi origin. So I think there is a natural sort of catchment area to be talking to. There is a Punjab which is changing, and you know, we see it when we send our emails. It's not that you won't get a response. There will be folks who will say, where is the investor? We'd like to speak to them. We can do a handholding. Can we go forward in discussing this proposal? And the conditions on the ground are getting better. So I think the big picture point here is that this is a Punjab which is constantly changing, wanting to become much more investment friendly and wanting to engage with the diaspora and having the institutional structures to do this engagement. So what I was going to suggest to Vipul as a next practical step in this is to have a similar roundtable with Invest Punjab. Let Punjab put together its point of view of how, what kind of investment it is soliciting, and let us give, and the Punjabi community here, give a very honest feedback of why we are not stepping up engagement or why we weren't so far, and what are the hurdles we face and what is it that can be fixed in a quick period of time. So I'm certainly going to suggest a sort of feedback session where we can channel all these ideas and take forward a conversation with Punjab.
Absolutely, I would love to do so. And as you are aware, I have already reached out to them, a couple of times, and waiting for their confirmation of participation. So whenever they are available, we'll be more than happy to do so. I can also bring in other chambers, the Canadian Chamber or the Ontario Chamber of Commerce, Toronto Region Board of Trade, and several other organizations, with thousands of members. I'm sure they would also love to know the opportunities. When you work with Punjab, I mean, it's not just that you are investing in Punjab, but you are also benefiting from it, no matter which part of Canada you live in. Because right now it's in a virtual world. I mean, you can do business with practically anybody, anywhere, and there could be knowledge transfer, there could be technology transfer, many, many areas where both countries can benefit. So yes, I look forward to your guidance on Invest Punjab, and happy to do so.
You know, absolutely, Vipul. And the point, that's also an important point to make, because we have been talking of giving back in terms of charity, in terms of adopt a village, people adopting villages or setting up schools and so on. That is on the one side, that is wonderful, most welcome. But here we are talking of investment opportunities, and returns. So when I talk to some pension funds here, for instance, I read out to them their portfolio. Look, you're in the US and Canada, and you're getting 2% and 3% and 4% in the last 3 years. Whereas people who've cashed out in India have got deals of 18%, 19%, or certainly assured deals in the 13%, 14% kind of range. So we're also talking of harnessing business opportunities, not just an opportunity to give back, but an opportunity to be adventurous in perhaps a slightly riskier market, but one that also gives higher returns.
Absolutely. Vaibhav, being in India, being into real estate, into several other sectors, can certainly say a word or two on that.
I know, just in that regard, India definitely is now the land of opportunities, and the kind of returns that are promised here are much, much better than the developed markets. It definitely comes with some element of risk, but there is now some element of stability also, which is promised on the horizon. In fact, as Vipul mentioned, and Your Excellency, that one of the questions that I also had in mind was, how a larger Indian setup can benefit from the technology aspects that exists, or the technology that is there. It is an intent and a desire now to look at making in India and delivering more promise out of the Indian ecosystem, which exists today, and that remains to be one of the key areas where India can benefit by complementing things which are already existing in the Indian ecosystem, such as cost-effective manpower and especially engineering manpower that is now available in the country, and clubbing it with the utilization of high engineering and precision engineering that's somewhat of Canada's strength as well in some parts. You know, when I talk about aviation and composite manufacturing capabilities as well, you know, this is something which is a large cluster in central Canada. So these are areas, and that's one of the ambitions, I guess, from Indian company side as well, is how the matchmaking can happen. So I know the Invest India part is always keen on the companies which are inward and looking India inward. But what about the Indian companies that want to go out there? They're sort of lost in a big ocean of how to find the right company and sort of who can go in there and give them that stamp of merit that can say, look, these guys are also good guys to you know, talk to and work together with, because a matchmaking needs somebody to put some sort of a credibility to your name on the other side as well. Because again, you need the best of both worlds to come and make something which is going to be looked after.
Absolutely. You know, I mean, I can see maybe Pavi wants to say something, but before that, just one line to add. See, there's a reason why I named this project as New Punjab, Pyara Punjab. I mean, it's been Pyara for forever, you know, Pyara Punjab, especially to people from India. But this is also a New Punjab, you know. It's all about development. It's all about progress. It's all about looking ahead, you know, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years from now. And overall in India, I would say, not just Punjab, but overall, the mindset is now on development, on growth, on future, on a better future for its own people and for everybody. So that's what we want to project and promote, you know, New Punjab and Pyara Punjab. And today's roundtable, I think, is a step in that direction. So Paviji and Suprit, still, if you want to come in.
Yeah, I think the only sort of point, I think I agree with Vega, you know, I think he makes a great point, which is it's not one way, it's actually two ways. And there's a lot of Indian companies that, you know, can grow and develop on the international stage. And I think that, you know, getting those, you know, sort of opportunities on the table as well is important. He's obviously part of a very successful international, you know, sort of group, but there are, I'm sure, others that, you know, would welcome the opportunity of expanding overseas. And I think that, you know, there's clearly opportunities to do so in terms of whether it's technology or other areas where India has, you know, a great deal of strength that can make a real impact in the world.
I agree with all of the comments. I think, you know, even from my perspective, what I'm seeing is whether, you know, we sort of pursue more organized forums to bring some of these you know, these potentially partnered opportunities together. I think organically and from a grassroots perspective, it's already happening. I see a ton of, you know, outreach coming, you know, across my table through the bank, where investors are looking for opportunities from India here. And likewise, you know, folks are starting to see some of the opportunities there. So I think the more we can do to highlight those opportunities, and knowing that you have you know, some great global, you know, banks that are ready to help, selfishly, us being one of them. But, you know, certainly, I think there's a great deal of interest across to help to promote, you know, the coming to life of any of these types of partnerships and opportunities that we've been discussing. The more, Vipul G, I think that you can do to highlight, I think is great. But I just want to call out that I think, you know, people are recognizing that organically as well through their various industry opportunities and outreaches.
I would like to talk. There's a feature of risk management in there, and I've been invested twice in India. So I guess the investors, if they do their homework properly and pick up the right partners, it's a great opportunity. You just can't walk in there and do this. You have to do your homework, make sure you have the right partners, and take the government help and any source you want to. And you can invest. The returns are, it's not the common theme, though it's very risky to invest. No, it's risky if you don't do your homework and you don't get the right partner. If you do your homework and get the right partners, it's smooth sailing.
Sure. So just one thing I would like to add before we close the roundtable is from my limited experience in participating and hosting and organizing such roundtables, conferences, events, is the one thing that I've heard more often than not is the follow-up or the lack of a follow-up. You know, people do participate, they do speak, there is genuine interest, but for one reason or the other, sometimes the link is broken, there is no follow-up, you know, people are unable to connect again, to follow up on what they discussed. I mean, everybody is busy, you know, we are all running big businesses. So it's a little bit difficult to keep in touch or to follow. That's why I keep bugging, you know, so many of you all the time, constantly, because I know it's important to stay engaged, to keep those connections alive, and to build upon it, you know, meaningfully. I mean, just having one conversation is not going to, you know, do any meaningful investment on the ground. It will require a series of conversations, dialogues, communications. So I would urge everyone, you know, today and going forward to stay engaged with each other by emails or by phone calls, you know, and if everybody's okay, they can share their contact information. I would like to create a group also so that we can have some continuity, you know, in this 18-month long project, so that when we connect to the 10 new people, we don't lose contact with the previous 10 people, you know? I think that's what I would like to suggest. And I can be the medium where we can connect everybody, keep everybody engaged, and then learn and look forward to your guidance for the same. So anybody wants to make a quick closing remark before I deliver my closing remarks?
Thank you. We're done. So
yes,
thank you very much.
Yes, absolutely. So as I said, it was 10:30 to 12. So we are just about there. So thank you all for such a wonderful roundtable today. As I mentioned earlier, there will be many more such interactions in the days to come. But this was a perfect start today. I couldn't have asked for anything better. The High Commissioner, sir, looking forward to Invest Punjab roundtable. And I look forward to, again, your support, referrals, guidance over the next 18 months. Thank you again to ICICI Bank Canada, Tangentia, Surti Sweetmart, Senega College, High Commissioner Sri Bisaria Ji, and Consul General Apurva Srivastava Ji for their continued support. So that brings the roundtable to a close. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. And all the best to everyone. Thank you.
Great seeing everyone. Okay.